going to change this country, and we will change the world.
For millions, the election of Barack Obama to the Oval Office marked a new era of hope. The young, energetic president was eager to take on the great challenges of his time.
Our combat mission in Iraq will end.
Now is the time to finally keep the promise of affordable, accessible health care for every single American.
Let's go get them. It's game time.
But change would be harder than Obama had predicted.
Am I frustrated that we're not taking bolder steps? Absolutely.
He said, I'm president of the United States and I can't make anything happen.
He said, you know, I don't sleep at night very much.
He called me a name that I hadn't heard before or since and stormed out of the room.
In these four programs, Barack Obama and his inner circle tell the story of what happened when he tried to reshape America from inside a White House unlike any other in history.
I am temperamentally optimistic and tend to take the long view.
In tonight's program, how Obama sparked a bitter conflict and risked his entire legacy with one piece of legislation.
This health care bill will ruin our country. It's time to stop it.
When we go out there, it's going to be shock and awe, take no prisoners, scorched earth policy, what else, carpet bombing, and that's just the first day.
In his first weeks in office, Barack Obama had to put his bold reforms on hold. He was fighting off a new Great Depression.
Well, apparently Phil knows a real good Thai restaurant.
As soon as he could, he brought his team together to decide how best to use the first Democratic majority in Congress for 15 years.
Hello, everybody.
We're sitting in the Oval Office of the President right after the stimulus bill passed, trying to decide what to do next. We have what can only be considered as a family fight. We had all of these bills that had to get done that the President felt very strongly about. We called them planes, and we were air traffic controllers trying to decide how to land the planes.
The healthcare cadre really felt that this was a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity with the Congress composition that we had, that Democratic presidents had been trying for 100 years to get this done, hadn't been able to do it, and that this the time was now.
Some people were advising the president, because the challenges were so great, to pull back on the agenda a little bit, maybe not do healthcare.
You know, you were dealt a very lousy hand, but fighting this recession and not having it turn into the second Great Depression, that will be a major accomplishment. And that if that's all you accomplish, you've done an amazing thing for the American people.
My advice was, let's do financial reform first. More likely to get it, more likely after the stimulus to be bipartisan than partisan, and therefore created the context for healthcare.
My job was to advise him on the politics, and I knew that seven presidents had tried, seven presidents had failed.
You know, there's a mythology that gets absorbed by politicians about what issues are winners and what issues are losers. And the conventional wisdom would have been that this is political suicide.
The president stood up and said, look, I just went around the country for 2 years running for president. And every single one of you know that the right thing to do is healthcare, but you're afraid of it.
I felt it was critical to try. I thought that not only the political costs, but more importantly, the moral costs to not trying were just too high.
From the state of Massachusetts, Edward Kennedy.
No one had tried harder than Obama's mentor and friend, Senator Ted Kennedy.
National health insurance is the great unfinished business on the agenda of the Democratic Party. Our party gave Social Security to the nation in the 1930s. We gave Medicare to the nation in the 1960s. and we can bring national health insurance to the nation in the 1970s.
30 years later, Kennedy, knowing he had only months to live, had passed the baton to Obama.
Lead the world. With Barack Obama, we'll break the old gridlock and finally make health care what it should be in America, a fundamental right for all, not just an expensive privilege for the few.
When Obama became president a year later, he inherited a healthcare system where Americans paid for private medical insurance. The government covered veterans, the old, and the very poor. One in six Americans had no insurance at all. His senior advisor, David Axelrod, had experienced the unfairness of the health system. His daughter, Lauren, had been ill since she was 7 months old.
For 19 years, she had uncontrolled seizures. And when I was a young newspaper reporter, the treatments and the medication that she cost weren't covered by my insurance, and we couldn't change insurance because she had a pre-existing condition. So I was one of those Americans who almost went bankrupt. I was paying $10,000 a year out of pocket on a $38,000 a year salary. I knew the health system wasn't working. It certainly wasn't working for us.
Obama knew it would be unrealistic to create an American NHS. Instead, he set out to fix the insurance-based system.
It was not a revolution in healthcare, but a series of reforms that would fill the gaps in healthcare coverage in this country.
No more what they called gender rating. Women were paying 48% more for their health insurance than men. Insurance company couldn't deny you health insurance for what they termed cesarean section as a pre-existing condition, or even a childbirth, a pre-existing condition, or a circumstance of violence against women, a pre-existing condition. 45,000 people a year were dying because they did not have health insurance.
Universal coverage and making sure that the moral dimension of healthcare is dealt with, don't think that we can get that done without excuse me. It's a healthcare forum, so I thought I'd, you know, model what happens when you don't get enough sleep.
At his White House launch, Obama hosted supporters as well as big healthcare interests like the drugs and insurance industries. He was determined to stop them lining up with the Republicans against him.
But I'm confident if we come together and work together, we will finally achieve what generations of Americans have fought for and fulfill the promise of healthcare in our time. So, let's get to work. Thank you.
The president's healthcare plan was going to be the core component of his administration. And the corporations that I work for, the political people that I work for, there was no support for it. And they wanted to find some way to defeat it.
There was no way we could support this. We felt it was a violation of a core principle of the Republican Party, a significant, massive increase in the size of the federal government, of interference with people's individual choices, their individual liberty.
Let's find out how these swing voters in Philadelphia felt about the Republican response and how Republicans are handling the Obama administration. Give me a word or phrase to describe what you just saw.
When the Republicans needed a phrase to rally the public, they turned to wordsmith Frank Luntz and his focus groups.
At one point, a woman raises her hand and she says, Frank, this isn't government control of health care. This sounds like a government takeover of health care. The word rings in my head. I look around and I see everyone going, I see the nodding of the head. And I knew I had it. I mean, you know it. You can feel it. If you really listen to voters, you get it. And I remember bursting out in this big-ass smile because I wanted them to know this is it. These are the words.
Just because Frank says it's going to work doesn't mean it's actually going to work until you've actually tried it out. But this one clearly hit.
Luntz presented this phrase, government takeover, to his clients, the Republicans in Congress, at their weekly private lunch.
This bill is a fiscal Frankenstein. It's a government takeover. It's not democratic.
As members started to use it and got a reaction from their constituents, They, of course, then start telling their colleagues, hey, I used this phrase. This is how I'm talking about it. This is really working.
The nearly $1 trillion government takeover of our healthcare system.
Luntz's phrase energized Americans who feared for their place in society. This was when the Tea Party took off, fighting what they called socialism.
Socialism is when you take my money and you give it to other people who don't deserve it because they never worked for it.
We're in a cultural war, and this war is a total war. The objective of the socialists that are driving the push for big government is to control all of education, to control the economy, to control our firearms, everything. Nothing is safe from those who think that government is the solution to every problem. A lot of us still think that government is one of the many problems that we need to solve.
6 months after Obama announced his health care reform, members of Congress broke up for their summer vacations. They went back to their districts to hold town hall meetings, usually polite question and answer sessions.
Me and members of my staff got kicked and spit on and yelled at and used the N-word. I mean, it was a nasty time. The sort of veins popping out of people's neck kind of anger, I had not seen on our soil in that way. We found that one of the only ways we could frankly keep things from getting totally out of control was to simply say, we're not gonna leave until everyone's had a chance to ask their question.
National health care, are you willing to have you and your family participate in the same plan you'd be voting in for your constituents?
It's a fair question. Let me say a couple things about it.
Night after night, we were doing 5-6 hour long town hall meetings.
As the Congress, you as my Congress.
You vote an individual mandate to have health insurance. I will seriously consider whether to take the public option or not.
There were dozens of people lined up at the microphone, kind of screaming and yelling about issues and how dare you do this and how dare you do that. And a woman came to the microphone and shook her hand at me and said, you have to promise me that you will keep government out of my Medicare. The irony of the question is that Medicare is 100% government funded program. It is a single payer plan run, but I promised her that I would indeed do just that.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
The town hall meetings unnerved Obama's advisors. They feared that they were losing support in the country and in Congress.
All right, let's go. Let's start with legislation. Phil?
Health care is the next 3 weeks in committee.
The president felt we had a failure to communicate properly on the health care bill. And anytime failures to communicate came up, I took that very personally because that was my portfolio. But I was frustrated because he had been told on the front end by me and others that it was going to be very difficult to communicate.
When you give him bad news, he asks very good questions. He doesn't react in anger or emotion. But you could tell he was just sort of weighing all this in his mind and really thinking about what do we do next.
For me to say, I'm quitting, I'm giving up, didn't hold a lot of appeal to me. So did I doubt that we might be able to get this done? Absolutely. I thought that, we're just not gonna be able to navigate all the challenges that are involved here.
He was getting a lot of advice to shift to a smaller approach on healthcare, that the window had closed in getting a comprehensive bill passed.
You could always count on Phil Schillero to come up with a solution, and it would be always the third way that worked. And the president said, Phil, what's that third way? And Phil, who's normally a very optimistic person, kind of looked down and he said, well, you know, Mr. President, unless you're feeling really lucky, I'm not sure there is a third way. And so the president gets up and he walks around the office and he starts to look out the window. We're kind of wondering, what's he doing? And he said, Phil, where are we? And Phil said, sir, we're in the Oval Office. And he said, and what's my name? And Phil said, well, President Barack Obama. And so the president turned around with this great smile on his face. He said, well, then of course I'm feeling lucky.
He said, I'm a black guy named Barack Obama, and I'm president of the United States. I feel lucky all the time.
The president decided he's still going to go forward and make the decision we can get across the finish line. He had to make the case. So he went before Congress in September, a joint session.
I realize that many Americans have grown nervous about reform. Some of people's concerns have grown out of bogus claims spread by those whose only agenda is to kill reform at any cost. Under our plan, no federal dollars will be used to fund abortions. Now, my health care proposal has also been attacked by some who oppose reform as a government takeover of the entire health care system.
One of the Republicans said something most unusual and uncharacteristic of the decorum that we usually have in the House, which I won't repeat.
The reforms I'm proposing would not apply to those who are here illegally. It's not true.
I gave him my mother of five look. No, I think it was worse than that.
The time for bickering is over. The time for games has passed. Now is the season for action.
The previous attempt to pass a health care law failed when the White House tried to impose a bill on Congress. Obama's strategist was not going to let him repeat that mistake.
And one of the things that seemed very important is not to have the president put out his own bill. I thought if he did that, he'd be putting a bill that potentially could pass the House, but not the Senate. Or it would be able to pass the Senate, but not the House. And so for this one, it made sense to have the bills get developed in each chamber separately and then try to bring them together at the end.
As the bills made their way through Congress, Obama set out to sell his vision, as only he could.
You had a young woman who was diagnosed with cancer, but because she had a case of acne that the insurance company said hadn't been declared, they decided they wouldn't cover her. By the time her insurance was reinstated, her breast cancer had more than doubled in size. Now, these stories are heartbreaking. They are wrong. Nobody in America should be treated that way, and we are going to bring about change this year. I need your voice, so I want to know, are you fired up? Ready to go? Fired up? Ready to go? Let's go change the world. Thank you, everybody.
The mainstream Republican leadership had been wary of the Tea Party, but now, as the first vote in the House of Representatives approached, House Republican leader John Boehner courted them.
I'm going to stand with you and all freedom-loving Americans against this bill. Join us in saying no to a government takeover of health care. Join us in rejecting higher taxes and more deficit. Join us in defending our freedom. And join us in defeating Pelosi Care.
By a few votes, the health care bill passed in the House. Now it was the Senate's turn to vote on their bill. But the Senate Democrats were fighting amongst themselves about the public option. This was government-run insurance to compete with the private companies. The party's right wing feared the public option was the first step to a national health service.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning, Senator.
Senator Joe Lieberman was at the heart of this group of conservative Democratic senators.
I thought if the U.S. government took over health care, or there was a public option that would be the beginning of, talk about the camel's nose under the tent, that it would eventually lead to an enormous increase in federal spending.
Lieberman could kill the bill. It took 60 senators to end debate on a bill, exactly the number of Democratic votes. Lieberman's vote was the 60th.
The Democratic leaders say you're holding the president hostage.
Oh, goodness.
The president told me, Harry, this legislation is more important to me by far than my re-election. This is going to do something to change America, and we've got to get this done. Joe Lieberman caused me a bit of trouble on national TV.
You got to take out the Medicare buy-in. You got to forget about the public option. I left the studio, and probably 5 minutes afterward, in the car going home, Harry Reid called me and said, can you come to my office this afternoon? And I said, look, I think there's a lot here for the liberal part of the Democratic Party to stick with, and nobody can get everything.
It was a bitter pill. There were many members on the liberal side of the spectrum anxious to include public options, but Lieberman's decision closed the door.
There was no public option in the bill when the senators arrived for the vote on Christmas Eve. A blizzard had crippled the Capitol's transport system. The only danger now for leader Harry Reid was that if even one Democrat failed to turn up, the bill couldn't pass.
A Republican senator from Oklahoma said Senator Byrd was very old. And the senator from Oklahoma said he hoped he died during the night, so we would be short one vote.
92-year-old Democrat Robert Byrd had been a senator since before Obama was born.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How do you feel?
Good.
How do you feel about working on the day before Christmas?
Oh, I do what duty tells me to do.
Mr. Byrd.
This is for my friend, Ed Casey.
Mr. Reid of Nevada.
And finally, it's going to pass. I vote no. For a few seconds, I just was so engrossed in my thoughts that I guess I was so used to voting no and stuff, it was a surprise to me to vote and actually get something done.
Mr. Reid of Nevada, aye.
Well, we changed it real quick, yeah. But it was a little embarrassing.
Later that day, Obama headed off for Christmas with his family. Now all he needed was for House and Senate Democrats to agree how to combine their two bills.
I'll be rolling up my sleeves and spending some time before the full Congress even gets into session, because there are a lot of provisions that are both in the Senate and the House bill. I actually think that reconciling them is not going to be as difficult as some people may anticipate.
In the early spring of an election year, the members of Congress, their attention naturally turns away from his agenda onto their own reelection. And he knew that, you know, it's like turning over an hourglass and the sands are just going down really fast then.
The president decided to do something that was quite unusual. I don't know that it had ever been done before for a particular piece of legislation like this. He held and led several days of meetings in the cabinet room.
Senate Democrats and House Democrats argued and squabbled and said they were going to get up and leave. There was a lot of anger, a lot of emotion.
What we're talking about, in my estimation, was getting a bill. And I had to protect my senators and make sure I didn't give up too much.
There were certain things that the senators were just not going to put in their bill, or that they would have in their bill that we objected to.
The president was getting a little exasperated, and we all were. We were all tired of it. We took a break and went in across the hall to the Oval Office. He said, you know, I think I've just about done everything I can do here. And Rahm said, you know, you're right.
At a certain point, your presence, they got to know that you have a price.
It doesn't add anything for you to stay another 2 hours. In some sense, they're enjoying debating in front of you.
This debate was about money. The Senate had a plan to cut costs that the House opposed. The chief of staff saw a way to break the deadlock. Obama had to back one side.
I'll make sure they know what the price is. You don't have to do that.
The president stood up in place and he said, that's it, I'm finished. If we can't get the Democrats to agree on this, we don't have a chance. Obviously, my presence here is not helping. As far as I'm concerned, this meeting is over. I'm going to bed. And he walked out of the room. And there was this lull, this pause. And Pelosi started picking up her papers. Reid started picking up his papers. And at that point, Rahm Emanuel stood up and said, stop. We can't leave this way.
I said, there will not be a bill with his signature without it. So let's go on to the other items, since that he's already decided what he wants. And his signature is the only way it becomes law. That was kind of like about 10 to 12.
Rahm saying, all right, Henry, you take this, you take that, and does this work, Nance? And, you know, so that's how we kind of finally got it done, and people agreed, this works.
As soon as Congress reconvened, the Democrats would pass this combined bill, and health care would be law. But then a Democrat in Boston, Massachusetts, said something that would undo all their work. A by-election was underway to fill the Senate seat of Ted Kennedy, who had died of cancer. Democrat Martha Coakley was the front runner until she offended Boston's Red Sox fans.
When asked why all the backroom dealing, she told the Boston Globe, as opposed to standing outside Fenway Park in the cold, shaking hands?
You could not think of a comment more calculated to antagonize people in the state of Massachusetts. When the president came in, I told him what had happened, and he started leaping up and down, shouting, she didn't say that. No, she's going to lose. She's going to lose.
It never crossed my mind that a Republican might win the special election to replace Senator Kennedy. It was inconceivable. This is, after all, the People's Republic of Massachusetts.
Obama rushed up to campaign, but it was too late.
Oh my God. A Republican is going to win this seat, and more importantly, it's going to give Republicans 41 votes in the Senate, which is the magic number. That means we can stop the health care bill in its current form.
He was almost clinical in the way he was looking at it, asking each person, so what does this mean? What does the election mean? What are our options here? How is there a way to still get health reform done?
It was seen not just as a harbinger of doom for the health care law, but also as a harbinger of doom for the Obama presidency in many ways.
I teared up. And I remember thinking, this is terrible to do this in the Oval Office. I didn't openly cry, but, you know, I was tired anyway, really tired. I knew that he wasn't giving up, but in my heart, I wondered if he should. It's not expected that the president and that the incumbent party does well in a midterm election, but we were starting to get really worried about what would happen.
my attitude was that we were close enough to the finish line when we lost that 60th vote in the Senate, that coming up with some creative legislative maneuvers was in the realm of possibility. Once you're halfway up a mountain, a lot of times it's easier to just keep on going up rather than trying to back your way down.
And the only path was going to be to convince the House to pass the Senate bill, which the House didn't want to do because it disagreed with parts of the Senate bill. And I knew that was going to be enormously unpleasant.
Obama rang the Speaker of the House.
The president said, you just go pass the Senate bill in the House. I said, my members won't vote for it. They will not vote for it. There are issues, there are provisions in the bill that we are not ever going to support. And so we're not doing that.
I knew the odds that day were very low, if the vote were that day, that the House would pass the Senate bill. That wasn't the key issue. The key issue was, with Nancy Pelosi leading the House Democrats, could they eventually pass the Senate bill?
She had at least as much to lose as I did because she had upcoming elections, and she knew that this might be costly given how poisonous the atmosphere had become.
Pelosi agreed to try. 1 week later, she put Obama's suggestion that they pass the hated Senate bill to the House Democrats.
Many people got up to the microphone and said that we had to back down, that the message from the Massachusetts election was that we should abandon health care reform and we should, at best, adopt a piecemeal approach. Many others got up and said that we should power forward and that the Senate bill wasn't perfect, but that we should continue to move it through. There was loud, vocal, noisy disagreement at that first caucus meeting, and a lot of people were very scared.
But Pelosi wouldn't give up. She came up with an ingenious plan that might persuade House Democrats to save health care. She would take advantage of a rule that special bills that save the government money need only 51 votes in the Senate.
We made a list of all the objectionable, not all, but reasonable list of our objections to the Senate bill. And then we said to the Senate, we need a letter signed by 51 Senate Democrats that they will pass these provisions when we send them over. Now we'll pass the Senate bill and then we'll send these additions over to the Senate, and we need the commitment of 51 that they will change that. That's the only way that we're gonna have a healthcare bill, because we're not passing the Senate bill the way it is.
This was unprecedented, but Harry Reid promised to get Pelosi her letter. He'd get 51 senators to sign a pledge that they would vote for the changes the House wanted. But he insisted their names would not be revealed.
I just didn't feel it was appropriate. I didn't want people going around saying, did you sign it? Did you not sign it? So,
I can't recall the exact number. There were some that were written in a very faint hand.
The letter was never made public.
I just read the letter, respected the word of those members, told my members, I've seen the letter, I'm satisfied.
Many of her members would take more convincing. Meanwhile, Obama visited the Republicans at their annual retreat. For a year, he had been seeking their cooperation. The White House suggested that the meeting be broadcast live.
The leaders are walking him into the event, almost as if they're security guards. And he's, you know, standing tall, he's got a smile on his face, he's looking very presidential, straight ahead. And then there are all the Republican House leaders who are looking down at their shoes. You can see on their faces, I wish I wasn't here, and I wish I wasn't escorting this guy into our retreat.
You know what they say, keep your friends close, but visit the Republican caucus every few months. Frankly, how some of you went after this bill, you'd think that this thing was some Bolshevik plot.
He's very combative, much more than I expected. Some of the Republicans were asking not the most effective questions, and he was batting them away.
No. Hold on a second, guys. You know, Mike, I've read your legislation. I take a look at this stuff. It can't be all or nothing one way or the other.
And he starts to complain about the political process and how poisoned it is, and how partisan it is, and how negative it is.
Unfortunately, that's how our politics works right now. That's how a lot of our discussion works. That's how we.
And he looks at me, and he gets this smile on his face, and I'm looking at him, assuming he's looking three tables behind me.
All the talking points, you know, I see Frank Lutz up here sitting in the front. He's already pulled it, and he said, you know, the way you're really gonna, I've done a focus group, and you know, the way we're gonna really box in Obama on this one, or make Pelosi look bad on that one. I know, I like Frank. We've had conversations between Frank and I, but that's how we operate. It's all tactics. And it's not solving problems.
Now, understand that when the President of the United States, I don't care who he is, calls out your name, the first thing you try not to do is faint. I don't want to sound like some kind of weak-kneed guy, but I wasn't expecting it. But he doesn't leave me alone. He's like, there's Frank Luntz. He's got his computer. He's taking notes. And he was kind of telling the truth. I had been taking notes that I was going to present to them that afternoon in how to respond to the president.
All right. Thank you, everybody. God
thank
bless
the president. Of the United
God bless the United States.
Even if Obama didn't convince a single Republican, 218 House Democrats would be enough to pass health care. The president and Phil Schillero had their work cut out.
We didn't have 218. We were in the low 200s, 205, 208, depended on the day.
Phil carried around a card that he kept inside his breast pocket of his jacket. It was sort of like a forced ranking from the least likely to support down to the most likely. So the ones at the top were the ones that we needed to work on. And every morning, we would sit and go through that list.
Top of the list was Congressman Bart Stupak. Stupak led a coalition of Democrats who were against abortion.
Well, I really have a dilemma. One principle, I want to see health care pass. 45,000 Americans die one every 12 minutes because they don't have health care. Then over here, I don't want to have federal funding paying for abortions, so young children cannot be born.
Obama wanted to keep abortion out of the debate, but Stupak had enough allies in the party to kill the bill. And the Republicans were happy to join him. They were almost all anti-abortion, pro-life.
I'm from what you might call a big family. I've got 11 brothers and sisters. I'm sure it wasn't easy for my mother to have 12 of us, but I'm glad we're all here.
Stupak had written an amendment to guarantee that government money could not pay for abortions. Effectively, this would also stop private insurance companies from selling abortion coverage.
They would have prohibited women from paying with their own funds in addition to preventing federal funds from being used. That we could not allow
to happen.
No one was willing to talk to me or move this legislation along, and my little coalition was saying we're not voting for it unless we get an opportunity to vote on life issues.
How close are you to a deal again?
Getting there, getting there.
I get my office. We love you, Congressman. Claims for you. Stand for life, sir.
We would not be able to get to 218 unless we can pick that lock and figure out how to solve it and accommodate their concerns and then the concerns of people on the other side.
And I'd like now to introduce Sister Keehan, or as we say, yester, it's your podium.
The White House turned to a powerful ally within the Catholic Church to help them remove abortion from the healthcare debate.
Madam Secretary.
Sister Carol Keehan was CEO of the Catholic Health Association, the largest nonprofit provider of healthcare in the U.S.
She and I talked quite a bit about it, and I suggested that the president call her, and he did. And she was convinced. They had a good rapport and trust, and she was convinced that President Obama had no intention of covering abortion.
The president had said at the joint session of Congress, there will not be federal funding of abortion in the bill. So even the pro-abortion people knew they weren't going to get federal funding of abortion.
But Obama's words were not enough for the Conference of Catholic Bishops, who had been working closely with Stupak over his amendment. Sister Carol went to Chicago to meet the head of the bishops, Cardinal Francis George. She hoped to persuade him to believe the president and issue a joint letter that united the Catholic Church behind the bill.
Well, I went to his home, spent 2 hours with him. We walked through all the pieces of the bill, all the concerns, all the potential for being double-crossed, the various discussions that we'd had with the White House and with the members of Congress.
This was a way to help the poor. That was what she saw, and I can see why she saw that. But she was of the opinion that we could take care of everything else after it was passed again. And we were saying that it would be too late, and we must stay together on this.
I faxed him a letter at his office and at his home saying, time is running out. We either go on record together or we're going to lose the opportunity to push this bill over the line.
And I didn't get that to her in time. I did delay.
With just a few days left before the vote, Sister Carol had to decide whether to go it alone. If she did, she would expose a rift in the church.
I was doing my little column that I do every 2 weeks. For many people, we'd just be seen as a dinky little newspaper that goes to our members. I've said, now is the time to get the job done. We need to get this bill passed. I didn't think it would amount to a hill of beans.
Catholic nuns are breaking from their bishops and supporting the health care bill.
By Friday evening, I was getting calls from everybody.
Who would you bet on in a fight if the fight is between Congressman Bart Stupak on one side and 59,000 nuns on the other side? Say it with me now. 59,000 nuns sent a letter to House lawmakers today urging them to pass the Senate health reform bill.
What do you make of the large organization of religious orders, of religious nuns? What do you make of them coming out for the bill as it's written?
Well, with all due respect to the nuns, when I deal or when we're working on right-to-life issues, we don't call the nuns. I mean, we deal with...
When they asked me about it, it did catch me by surprise because, I mean, the media told me about it.
Why are the bishops more reliable than the nuns?
Well, because I don't think I've ever been, in my 18 years, I don't think I've ever had been contacted by the nuns to on legislation. It's seldom do you see that. They're not considered one of the groups that's actively involved up here on issues. They may surface, they may write a letter, but they're not up here talking with members, and they're not the recognized spokesperson for the Catholic Church.
I met with certain members of Congress who were pro-life and who had the same concerns we had. And it really wasn't so much an attempt to persuade as to explain how we got to where we were.
People who actually understand how the healthcare system works, like Sister Carol, and understood how the bill worked, ended up just having a lot more knowledge of reality.
She brought the CHA into a position where publicly they were opposed to the bishops. That's an extraordinary thing for somebody that calls herself Catholic to do. And so it also threatened the unity of the church, as well as influenced public policy.
The bishops either didn't understand the bill or were trying to do something other than they, you know, just wanted to stop the bill. So we were never going to find common ground with them, with the bishops. But the nuns, thank God for the nuns.
Stupak's anti-abortion coalition had shrunk to six. If the White House could win them over, Obama would have the 218 votes he needed. He had one more weapon. He could issue an executive order, a presidential decree that guaranteed abortion rules were not going to change.
We knew if we put it out there too soon, the idea of the executive order from the president, that the opposition would form around it and there'd be something wrong with it. And on the other side, the women members would get more upset and it just wouldn't work. So it was on purpose, a last minute effort to resolve everyone's concerns, and it had to be timed just exactly right.
Well, on this beautiful morning, we are here to mark the passage of a welcome piece of legislation for our fellow Americans who are seeking work in this difficult economy.
Obama chose his moment carefully. 3 days before the health care vote, he invited Congressman Stupak to the signing of a jobs bill.
They have the bill signing ceremony. The president gets up, goes front row, shake all his sponsors' hands. He sees me, he reaches across, hey, Bart. Hello, Mr. President. He says, you know, we got to talk. I said, just give me my amendment. We'll get this bill done. He said, that ain't going to happen. I said, then we probably don't have a bill, Mr. President. He said, we'll talk. And then they said, hey, Ron wants to talk to you.
So I said, Bart, what if we did the executive order? Would need meet your objectives and allow you a path towards the president's. And at the end of the day, he sat on, you know, there's two couches that face each other, coffee table and the fireplace and the chief of staff. We sat across and worked out, I mean, two non-lawyers, we worked out the language around the executive order, and then I had the lawyers work with his team and draft it.
Stupak agreed. As they finalized the executive order, Cardinal George phoned.
The conversation with Stupak was to encourage him, to ask him to be sure to hold fast, along with the very few pro-life Democrats that he had.
If I do what Cardinal George wanted, in other words, at the end, what he was encouraging me to do was to vote totally against health care because it did not have the Stupak amendment in there. Now, if I stick my head in the sand and say, you will not get my vote or the vote of my little coalition unless I get what I want, and they don't give it to me, and the whole bill goes down, what do I have? I have nothing. I have no health care. I have no protections for life.
Obama had hoped to pass health care in 6 months. Now, a year after he started, they were going to the final vote.
Let's go, guys. We are going to get this done. Every vote's going to count, because when it's all said and done, this is going to be a very, very close vote.
Use the word Armageddon. What did you mean by that?
This health care bill will ruin our country. It's time to stop it. Gotta vote.
A lot of us were in the Roosevelt Room watching it. Rahm and I had a side bet about a couple of members, whether we would get them or not.
On this vote, the yeas are 220, the nays are 211. The bill is passed.
It was one of those moments that you that reminds you of why you got into politics in the first place.
When we work in government, every day is history. Whatever the bill is, that becomes part of history. I think of it as little history and big history. And that night, as we were passing health care reform, that was big history.
I had a bunch of my staff up here to the White House residence. And we went up on the Truman balcony and toasted all these 25-year-olds and, you know, a bunch of people who had worked so hard.
Michelle and his daughters were away at the time, so the guys had the run of the apartment and decided to have a frat house party.
It was a very casual party. One of my favorite pictures, and I'm sure the president probably didn't put this one out, but he's holding a martini, and probably why he didn't put it out. But just the smile on his face is just, you can tell it was just the best moment of his life.
Other than his marriage, I don't know that I've ever seen him quite that happy. And so I asked him in the wee hours of the morning how he felt that night compared to election night.
The most gratifying moment that I've had in public life, more than my election as president, because you run and hopefully win elected office, not just for the sake of being something, but for the sake of doing something.
He was calling around to thank people that had tried to be helpful. Very gracious of him. I was in Paris, and I inadvertently let the president of the United States call go to my voicemail. You listen to your voice messages, and it's the president of the United States, and you think, oh, Lord, what did I do?
At the signing ceremony, Obama's vice president couldn't contain himself.
Thank you, everybody.
I felt numb. It was by then, I was starting to understand how hard this was going to be for the president, having achieved something of this landmark nature, that it was very polarizing too.
You see, by the dawn's early.
Even now, Obama's opponents refused to accept defeat. The only way to repeal Obamacare would be to take control of Congress. Tea Party activists who started by attending rallies now stood as candidates in the approaching midterm elections.
Hi, this is Governor Sarah Palin. I'm urging you to vote Renee Elmers for Congress. Renee will vote to repeal Obamacare.
I'm not a politician. I became a candidate because as a nurse, I'm concerned about what the Obama administration and Bob Etheridge were doing to our health care system.
He'll work to repeal Obamacare, cut spending, and slash the deficit. Labrador will stand up to Obama and Pelosi.
Up the revolution! Up the Tea Party!
Ladies and gentlemen, Sarah Palin.
We must not fundamentally transform America as some would want. We must restore America and restore her honor.
During the midterm campaign, Sarah Palin posted a map of the U.S. with crosshairs over the districts of vulnerable Democrats who had voted for health care. One was Congresswoman Gabby Giffords.
We're on Sarah Palin's targeted list, but the thing is that the way that she has it depicted has the crosshairs of a gun sight over our district. And when people do that, they've got to realize there's consequences to that action.
Another congressman targeted by Palin was Tom Perriello.
Make sure you get out and vote on Tuesday for one of the best congressmen Virginia's ever had, Tom Perriello.
Loyal Democrats were vulnerable. Unemployment was high, and Obamacare wouldn't be fully implemented for years.
There were members who came up to me after we all lost and said, well, if I'd known that we were all going to lose, I would have voted more like you. I wanted to vote for what I thought was right. And losing an election is just not the end of the world.
We have a big story to report tonight. At the top of this hour, NBC News is projecting that Republicans have won control of the House of Representatives. Further, we are projecting that when
Obama's only consolation was that the Republicans hadn't won enough Senate seats to repeal health care. But he had suffered a devastating defeat in the House. He had lost more seats than any president since 1938. And the Tea Party now had 60 Republican members.
There were a lot of individual members of Congress who ended up voting for this bill and losing their seats, in part because they were characterized as having supported Obamacare.
The next day, on Capitol Hill, it looked like a neutron bomb went off. Nobody spoke. People were walking down the halls like, wow, she lost. Hey, he's gone. Who do you think's gonna get her office? Everyone. It was total shock. Barack Obama was supposed to have changed America as we know it.
Because the process was so messy, the legislation wasn't as elegant as you would have liked, even if it's not perfect, then over time, we'll be able to look back 20 years from now and I think feel great satisfaction about what we accomplished.
I now pass this gavel, which is larger than most gavels here, but the gavel of choice of Mr. Speaker Boehner. I now pass this. I now pass this gavel and the sacred trust that goes with it to the new speaker. God bless you, Speaker Boehner.
Three days later, Gabby Giffords was shot in the head at her town hall meeting and lost the power of speech. Six others were killed. For the remainder of his presidency, Obama would not regain a majority in Congress. The Republicans would block all his other major reforms. They'd make over 60 attempts to repeal Obamacare. In next week's program, how Obama went to war.
I turned to the president and said, can I just finish the two wars that I'm already in before you go looking for a third one?
And launched a secret bid to prevent conflict with Iran.
The president took us aside and said he trusted us and basically don't screw it up.